Blackstone Publishing presents The Secret Life of Groceries, The Dark Miracle of the American Supermarket by Benjamin Lorr. This book is read by Benjamin Lorr. Murray came out of an aisle and walked alongside Babette, just ahead of us. He took a twin roll of paper towels out of her cart and smelled it. This place recharges us spiritually. It prepares us. It's a gateway. The large doors slide open, they close unbidden. Energy waves, incident radiation. All the letters and numbers are here, all the colors of the spectrum, all the voices and sounds, all the code words and ceremonial phrases. It is just a question of deciphering, rearranging, peeling off the layers of unspeakability. Not that we would want to. Not that any useful purpose would be served. Don DeLillo, White Noise. Introduction, Between the Ice and You. In short, her shopping is primarily an act of love, that in its daily conscientiousness becomes one of the primary means by which relationships of love and care are constituted by practice. That is to say, shopping does not merely reflect love, but is a major form in which love is manifested and reproduced. As Parker has noted, love for infants is inevitably accompanied by hatred and resentment. Daniel Miller, A Theory of Shopping. Let's look beneath the ice-chipped surface of a fish counter at a Whole Foods in New York City. This happens every other month after closing. The customers leave, the checkout crew changes into street clothes, the store goes into lockdown to prevent its own employees from robbing them. Shifts change, and the ceaseless, shitty Hall & Oates music stops and is replaced by silence. Night workers, a motley rainbow of low English, low skill, low smile workers, come in, knee pads over long pants to restock the shelves, like a reverse midnight harvest. They stoop over, heads down in their Kind Bar TM shirts, or whatever functional and empowering edible shelled out sponsorship money, kneeling there, glumly stacking yogurts. At the fish counter, the seafood team begins. Fish are removed, latex gloves gripping them two at a time, fillets and whole fish, sloppy little bastards, and tossed into the plastic tubs that are their nightly home. The mussels are bagged, the shrimp scooped together into mesh cages. Next, the metal trays come up. These are little more than decorative housing and are promptly sprayed down to remove a day's worth of sweat and oil and torn pieces of flesh that sloughed off from handling. Below the trays, a thin plastic webbing for grip, then a layer of ice. Once, individual chips, now grown hard as a skating rink from periodic thaws and re-icing during the day. The surface is littered with the typical debris, fish parts, crumpled up stickers announcing wild caught, errant cockles, cracked mussels. Usually that would be it. Aprons would be stripped off. Giant, foul garbage bags of fish guts and butcher paper would be lugged to the dumpsters in the back. But on this night, the one that comes every other month or so, the case itself is cleaned. An order has come down from high, seemingly at random. And so, for the entire length of the 38-foot case, employees hack the ice into large chunks. It is exactly like shoveling snow in the winter, and they use big, thick shovels to do the job. Standing up on metal platforms to get leverage, they chop straight down, chiseling out 2 by 2 by 2 blocks that they then systematically take out like giant sugar cubes to be melted in the back. It is reasonably physical work, and soon they are sweating. Once the top layer is removed, they begin anew on the layer below, gritting it out, chiseling, pulling out cubes. Beneath this second layer, the ice is more crunchy, less frozen. It's an old freezer and inconsistent, and it only takes a few scrapes before you get to streaks of brown. A few more and the smell comes. It is horrible, and not at all of decomposition, but of fecal waste, maybe sweetened slightly, thick in the air like you're exhuming something dangerous, which perhaps you are. Soon after the smell, the streaks of brown darken and the ice turns with entrails and smashed pieces of shell, the shovel uncovering squid tentacles, crab antenna. All 2 months old, rotten, buried under there, each scrape revealing some new purple color, and the odor is such that you really cannot breathe it long. So neither team member does, instead spelling each other by rushing off to do other tasks like melting the giant cubes under hot water, or just standing to the side and muttering, "How the fuck does it get like this?" Then, at a certain scrape of the shovel, the bottom of the case is revealed. Stainless steel, but it's streaked green with bile, gray with pancreatic froth, pink with clam flesh, all strung out and mashed in the ice slurry. To the extent that they are recognizable, the contents are inexplicable and vaguely horrifying. No shrimp were stored in this section of the case, so why the rotting pile of shrimp casings? No whole fish either, so why the set of red lacy gills?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.